Oh no, we can't let them see what goes on behind the scenes. Cause
you hear the helicopters.
Oh, dude, helicopters. So do we want to dive into the punching, or do we want to wait for Carl for the punching, or let's go right into the punching?
Let's just go right into the punching, and if he comes in, we can fucking sock him.
Well, it depends.
Oh, shit.
We have to ask
being him. Late. No,
well,
I'm playing.
Well, yeah, we have to ask him, does he advocate for any kind of anything that we think might lead to violence against us?
Probably not. He's quite a teddy bear.
I'm just saying, if he does, then we can punch him. You know,
right, yeah, because you know, hate speech is total grounds for violence.
Punching, yes, yes.
Just like the, you know, that's where I think righties and lefties could really get along.
Yeah.
Because you got the lefties who you know, say, you know, words are violence and stuff, and then you have the righties in their nap.
The holy nap.
The holy nap.
Well, there's also the holy nap. There's also two types of libertarians, too. There's the thin, and then there's the thick libertarians. And the thin libertarians, they're very kind of very thin, I guess, until you make an act of violence, and then you can defend yourself. And that's very logical. But then again, they ignore, just because they're thin, they ignore a lot of even the warning signs or anything like that also.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what would be a warning sign?
Well, the thing is, understanding politics a lot better, and understanding also particular anarchistic history to understand what's happening in front of us when we get confused. Like, a lot of people are getting confused without understanding that a lot of these things have been happening, and the thin libertarians are like, very new ANCAPs or new anarchists have not noticed signs, basically.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now let me.
Yeah,
I gotta ask Bodhi a question. Where is this being live streamed right now, sir?
On the Agora.
Okay, so the Agora. Okay.
I'm sharing it around now.
Okay,
sharing some of my groups.
I'm gonna get with the program there, and I see us there. I just want to make sure I'm in. I can see comments, and we're all. And we got, I'm for work in the AM. Oh, in for work in the AM. I thought he said, hey, Joel. He's in for work in the AM. I thought he said, nice. I'm for work in the AM. Like he was voting. Whoa!
Oh!
If he's voting.
That's a paddling.
That's a punch. If you're a voter, that's a punch. I just want to know. You're an 80-year-old woman and you vote. You get a punch.
You get a punch to the face.
You get a punch, and then you know what? No violation of the nap.
Nope. Hey, no. you step on my lawn that I arbitrarily defined, that I don't use half the time. You're gonna get punched.
Oh.
Oh, shit.
That you don't use half the time. Oh, you want to go down that property?
I don't think voters should get punched at all.
Why not?
No, I don't.
How many people are voting out there in the world?
That's a lot. I don't have enough fists.
Well, but, so what you're saying from a practical perspective, the standard of punching voters is not good. How about people who go to rallies and support candidates?
No punches at all. Unless, I mean,
why not?
If there's a fight that started at rallies, right? It's kind of hard to know who started the fight. Recent rally, right?
No, I don't mean like, okay, let's not go there yet. Well, I don't want to go there yet. Personally, I want to investigate why is it that I shouldn't be able to punch somebody at a rally who is standing in support of a candidate or an ideology that advocates for force against me. Why can't I punch them? Isn't that, I mean, that they're like, that they're violating the nap, aren't they?
But did anybody touch you?
No, but they're
did anyone violate you?
They're violating me through proxy, through
other, words,
through other people. No, they're
but did it happen
empowering.
Yet?
No,
did it happen yet?
But it could.
Could
it? Could.
That's the same reason we invaded the Middle East.
It's preemptive nappage. It's
fucked up.
Preemptive nappage, yes.
Preemptive nappage. It's a punch for liberty. Come on, dude.
It's a punch for liberty.
Punches for liberty. Dude, now that, I would wear that shirt.
You know the kind of punch I think
punches
these people...
Punches for liberty.
It's kind of, I don't know if they started drinking the Kool-Aid and there's something in it. I would recommend bleach additives for these individuals. See, that's not advocating violence. That's advocating that these people that are so willing to do violence just take care of the problem themselves.
Well, yeah, like I asked somebody today, how many people have you punched? Because they're advocating for, great, how many people have you punched? And I'd like to see how that works out, that strategy, when you go around punching people.
I've actually been punched before. Believe it or not.
No, I can't believe that.
Oh, God.
I like when I listen to you speak and I see your face, I'm like, that looks like a face that's been punched. You know?
I've been there before. And you want to know what I did in response?
What did you
do? I didn't punch back.
No, that I can't. I'm not with you on that. But, well, I can be, depending on the context. And
it was someone I care about. So and
your mom
it was very...
your mom punched you? No, it was your dad. It was your daddy hit you over the head with an axe handle, didn't he?
He did.
Because you threatened his football team.
Yeah.
You know I'm a peaceful man, but if you threaten my football team, the New England Patriots, it's gonna be a bad day.
He is not a Patriots fan.
You're going to have to make sure you get that part of the show that just happened and make sure that he gets that.
Yep.
Gets it too. He could be like the older base stick man, except now instead of this
base dad man, he's got all the jokes.
Yes, base dad man. Here comes base dad man. He's got a joke in one hand and an axe handle in the other, and it's up to you which one you get.
Holy crap.
But seriously, Ty, if we follow the nap, what is to say if they are, I mean, is it what Bodhi said? Is it a matter of, is it a pressing violence? What prevents me from punching somebody who's advocating for violence against me? They're not going to do it themselves. They're going to have other people do it. So what's to prevent me from punching them if I follow them?
Yeah. Yes, Tim.
I did. You. I'm not running the show, Bodhi. I just happened to ask.
What's it called? How would they stop you from punching somebody that will advocate a certain form of force?
No. Does the nap allow me to punch them? And if not, why not?
The nap. The nap is actually, that's the thing. The nap is a very subjective thing. And people can have many points about...
Now you're talking about selling children into slavery. That's where I'm going with it. Right?
Oh, shit.
That's the Jared Howe method.
Oh, voting for selling children into slavery. Wow. Somebody could get punished for that.
If you sell people's children into slavery, they might not care about principles anymore. And just...
they might not be looking up the holy book of nap to see what they should or shouldn't.
Hold on. Let me consult Rothbard.
Yes.
Let me consult Rothbard. Oh, man.
Right.
Nap is subjective. I mean, really people can say things like don't act until somebody attacks you directly. And some people might say you could act because these people are actually promoting a certain violent act.
That's what they're saying. That's what they're saying, that they're promoting a violent act that could and would and theoretically produce violence against you.
But then... If you're saying you're willing to do violence against someone who's professing to use violence against you, you're now doing the same exact thing.
How so?
No one's actually hurt anyone.
No, you're just defending yourself. They've initiated the violence.
But they haven't initiated it yet. They're just using words. I don't think it's okay to punch a Nazi, but I wouldn't punch a Nazi. But I can understand why people would want to punch a Nazi, but it doesn't mean I advocate it.
I will punch a Nazi, but I wouldn't Trump. I wouldn't punch Ebola. I have to be real. Like, if I literally seen a Nazi, like,
Nazis
down the
vote.
Street.
Nazis vote.
Nazis vote.
Yeah, it's true. Nazis vote. But me, when it comes to a Nazi itself, I will actually confront the situation. But
Don made a great point. We'll get to.
But not Trump's voters or supporters that don't even know what they're supporting or felt like they had no choice between Hillary and Trump and they just voted for Trump. Because think about it, only 25% of the whole country voted for Trump. That's a very tiny percentage. And then within that group of that 25%, there's a way smaller percentage of the different groups that are white nationalists. That's a very, you know, that are mixed in there. But they got mixed in there because the way Trump spoke, the rhetoric that he had attracted that group. And so it got mixed in, and then it's confusing people, I think, what's going on. And then the Trump supporters repeating certain things that they hear, like maybe they don't know is a neo-Nazi next to them, and they're repeating certain slogans as they are, and then a big old rumble, a big old fight starts to happen. And this is what people need to realize. Like, they're all confused. Even Trump supporters are confused of what's in that group. They're totally defending them with the whole white nationalist political slogans and excuses that they create. They've been doing this for a long time.
I think the best way to advance the cause of liberty and to see liberty rise in the land is, especially when your numbers are like less than 1%, especially then, when your numbers are less than 1%, you should go out and do violent things against the people that you're trying to convince not to embrace violence anymore.
That'll help. Definitely.
I think that's the path to liberty. And this is sarcasm, by the way, folks.
That'll definitely sort things out quite quickly.
It'll sort things out, yes. And you know what it'll do? It'll put people like you and Bodhi and myself, it'll put us up on the chopping block right along beside them.
Yeah.
So I would say, if you're advocating for punching Nazis or who you think might be Nazis, really, what it is who you think might be Nazis.
Yeah. Oh, I see.
They're saying, I'm going to punch them, they're Nazis. I'm like, you really don't know that. But
Computer world is confusing too. The internet is confusing also. They create a lot of confusion there. Yeah,
whether you're advocating for punching Trump supporters or communists, I could argue that your actions that you're going to perpetrate is going to put into motion certain things that are going to trigger a violent reaction against me, that are going to put me at risk of being a target of the state. And so I should be able to punch you.
I'll put it this way. There's really nothing stopping you from punching me.
No.
That's technically your ability. That's your right. But there are consequences to that action, and it's not a very wise decision if you're looking to create peace.
And some of the consequences are a violation of your own standards, which is the preferred deterrent. And some
but
of
that
the consequences.
Doesn't even...
Well, no, I, Vody. I mean, honestly, I've wanted to punch you so many times, and if you were in front of me, I would not have punched you, not because I feared repercussion. Or the state, or it would have been because it would have violated my standard that you don't punch Bodhi. It's a standard. It's like,
I'm really glad that that's all that's stopping you.
Standard number 312. Aren't you?
I feel swell.
Don't you? I mean,
I feel wow.
It's a more powerful deterrent, actually, because if your deterrent
for you, it's subjective.
It is. It's totally subjective.
Totally subjective. You want to know what stops me from punching people?
Why won't you punch me?
I don't have that much weight, and I probably wouldn't last very long. I'd have to knock you out.
So yours is a physical deterrent.
Yeah, I mean, if we were in a scrap, if we were scrapping it or whatever, like, I would just try to tire you out, and then I'd choke you out when you couldn't breathe anymore.
Oh, no.
I'd just sit on your face and fart.
That's so fine. You'll get tired eventually.
Not if I sit on your face and fart. I don't think you're going to last very long in that situation. I wouldn't last very long in that situation.
You'd run out of gas.
Well, no, I think that you'd run out of gas before I did. Metaphorically, yes, I think that there would be an expiration that would occur before my expiration.
Oh, really? You'd be surprised. I'm pretty scrappy.
We should test this.
We can fight.
No,
fine.
No, I don't want to fight you. I just want to sit.
There's gonna be a fight going on the show and shit.
I want to sit on your face and fart on you and find out how long you last. That's all. I mean, we'll do a scientific test. We're like 20 minutes. Can you last 20 minutes? And we'll figure if you could last 20 minutes, you probably could have freed yourself by then.
I don't think you would last 10 minutes with me.
Why? Because you'd try and kiss me and that would be like,
no,
that would gross
no,
me
I'd
out
gas
and...
you out. I'd no, I can last 10 minutes for sure. And you'd be out of breath.
Yesterday was the day that this would have been a good day because yesterday I had the fuel. I was stocked up. Yes, that's right, Don. Agora MMA. And we'll do it the only way that the Agora can. We'll take MMA and we'll turn it into a fart contest. I think that's only fitting, actually.
How did we get here?
I just want to let you know, I'm going first, as in I'm the one that sits on you first. If you die, you don't get to take a turn, so just...
I could always pull guard, and you're screwed.
No, you're not allowed to. You can't. You got to be passive and take that fart. Inhale it.
I'm out of shape, but I could get back. I'm going to start training again. Fuck
actually,
you.
I'm out of shape, too. Actually, right now, I have acid reflux, so I get winded really quickly.
Ooh, so a guillotine would be perfect.
Oh, yeah, I wouldn't last long. I mean, basically, yeah. I would have to do what you'd have to do. I would have to crush you quickly, or I'd run out of gas. But, of course, you know, actually, this is how I think a fight between you and I would start, when it would go. We'd wear the crap out of each other for about 3 seconds. And then we'd be like, time out. Hold on, time out. Hold on. You know what? Forget it. That's what it would be. Like, I think
No, Don, we're not in the same weight class.
No, we're not in the same weight class. I'm a little bit lighter. I think, Bobody, how much do you weigh?
3,000 pounds.
No, come on. How much do you weigh?
I think I'm finally at, like, I'm close to 160. So.
Oh, you're 160. I'm a little bit. Tiny bit more than that.
Tiny bit by a couple.
Just a tiny bit.
Probably like 40 pounds.
Maybe. Maybe. We'll just go with that. That sounds good. Yes. Let's just go with that. Ty, what's your weight class? Now that we're talking about getting the fights ready, what's your weight class? Ty?
Huh? Oh, my weight?
Yeah, your weight class.
I don't know. I guess I weigh. Well, how much I weigh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I put you in the right weight class. For the fights, we got to put all of us in the right class.
Oh, I see. I'm like 170.
Oh, so you and Bodie can fight. I'll be the referee. All right. Yeah. I'm just going to say I'd be super heavyweight. That sounds better. You're super heavyweight. Yeah. Oh, you mean you're fat?
Yeah. Oh shit. Yeah. Bodie's probably taller, a little bit taller than me, though.
I'm 6 feet. I'm 6 feet tall.
Oh yeah, you are taller than me. I'm like 5'7".
I'm lanky too. You got to watch the arm bars.
I'm
triangles.
I'm about 5'9", but I wear lifts. I do. I wear like 2-inch lifts, so my 5'9 becomes like 5'10, 5'11.
I like the way it makes your ass look.
Well, actually, the reason I do is because they actually really, I can walk longer with them for some reason. It doesn't hurt my legs and my feet don't hurt, so they're like a relief for me.
You should get wheelies.
Oh my gosh, I cannot roller skate. I can't.
No,
I mean,
the wheelies.
I mean,
they just have wheels to.
Heels.
wheels in the heels.
I know what wheelies are. Okay?
Imagine Bass Stick Man with wheelies.
It wouldn't have done well in the grass.
Nope.
He was in the grass. He would have been taken down.
I like how they got arrested after.
Yeah. So, anyway, we have digressed, and...
Yes.
I blame Ty for the weight loss comment, which is inappropriate. Actually,
oh,
somewhat a violation of the NAP, threatening me with a lack of food. That is definitely... Oh, no. That's definitely a violation of the NAP.
He's using his means of production. He's seizing his means.
I'm seizing my means.
Holding it against you.
So the punching thing.
The punching thing. It drives me nuts.
Why are you like?
Oh, that punching thing. Yeah. I think the punching thing started with somebody punching Richard Spencer.
Richard Spencer.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it became a joke, but it's not like that's what people do when they go out to protest is go punch people. It's like,
like I said,
Antifa and white nationalist groups have always been fighting each other for a very long time, like even before the 80s, 70s. This has been going on for a long time.
They were fighting each other back in Nazi Germany. In Weimar Germany, they were fighting each other.
Yeah.
A version of Antifa and a version of nationalists. They've been white nationalists. They've been fighting each other for a long time.
Yeah, and what's happening is, I think the mainstream media is taking advantage of a certain situation because what's going on is Antifa knows that white nationalist groups are showing up at Trump rallies. They're showing up at Trump rallies. And the people got to separate the two. People got to separate the fight between the white nationalists and the Antifas from the statist type of groups like Trump voters and supporters. But with that one recent march that happened, what Antifa did was they just block the march. So it's kind of hard to tell who started the fight.
Well, who gave the
right to throw the first hit, you know, who gave themselves? Did somebody say like, since you're blocking, I'm gonna push you, or did the other guys just started fighting when they got close? Like, what really happened?
I don't know, and you know, it's telling. It depends on whether you're looking at a site from the left or site from the right. You'll see different stories, and I don't know if there's video of how it actually unfolded. It looks like I've seen a few of the videos, and they're all like in the midst of it. They didn't capture the beginning.
Yeah,
so right. I'm not
That's
sure.
What I noticed
too. They're just jumping in the brawl, looking at the symbols and swinging. I bet you they've punched each other. Like I was watching some of the stick fights, and like they were just swinging indiscriminately.
Yeah.
It's like, what are you doing?
Everybody was, even on the other side, like, it was just going all over the place. Like, yeah, but, and also the article, it literally says that there was a neo-Nazi group. And I think the reason why they said neo-Nazi, I don't know if they were neo-Nazi, alt-right, or Proud Boys, or any type of white nationalist group. But they did say in the article, in the one article I read, it said there was a group of neo-Nazi there, good group of that. And I think they assumed that because he probably flashed the white nationalist signal. So, and I assumed that that's what happened. They seen it, and so they wrote it down also within the article that there was white nationalist people or neo-Nazis there. They said neo-Nazis, but I don't know if they were exactly neo-Nazis because that's a different political white nationalist group. Also,
but that article was written by the left, so it could
was?
Very. I think if you're citing the same one that that I saw, I can't remember, was it Huffington Post or Salon?
It was one of those.
But
I think it was the one that you had.
Yeah, from what I understand, that article was written by the left. So to the left, they're all Nazis. They're all white supremacists that are. But maybe like Ty is saying, and I think it's true. What's interesting is on both the left and the right, what you have going on, I would say, is this, that you have within the moderate wings of the left and the right, You don't have a cohesive, unifying, easy to understand vision. The far left extremist, the far right extremist, and all their variations, they have very clear ideologies, very clear visions, very clear goals. And I think that because it's kind of like, okay, if you have a force of five people up against 20, you know, not even against, but you have an organization where you have five people versus 20, and the 20 people, all their arrows are pointing in different directions, and you get this mm-hmm. this group of five people that comes in, all their arrows are pointed in the same direction, it's pretty quickly those five people will become the driver of the whole.
Yeah.
And I think that's why, even as the whole doesn't believe and understand what that core is advocating for. So you right. end
yeah,
up with
exactly.
So you end up with both of these sides, they're getting driven by, you know, Antifa is getting driven by very, very bad players. But the front lines of Antifa might not believe the kind of violence that the hardcore leaders believe in. They think they're just defending against racism. Meanwhile, right. the Trump supporters, I mean, I know a lot of these Trump supporters. They absolutely believe that they're standing up for liberty.
Right.
Yes, I know. Right. They believe that they're standing up for liberty. And so much of their, I mean, their rallies, the way they're being organized. Now, I do know organizers. I know some of them personally, and they're not far right. But when you get there, the ones that are whipping up the excitement, the energy, the action, the good signs, the good costumes, that's from the more fringe groups.
It so might even be probably curious. It might even be state driven.
You have
agitators.
You have state agitators. You know you have state agitators.
We talked about
agitators on all sides. Yeah.
Because why? Because then guess what? The violence breaks out, and you know what the state can do? You're all going to jail.
yeah. Exactly. Exactly.
You're playing into it. Put down the fucking weapons. Put down the fucking sword. Stop fucking punching people. Pull your head out of your ass and start talking. Figure it out. Grow the fuck up.
Don has a great idea. Agora needs to send Bodhi to every situation that comes up, like the more violent, the better. To every situation that comes up like this, our man on the ground with a camera. I think we need to crowdfund this. I need to make this happen. We need to send Bodhi out there. And Bodhi, I just want you to be your full, natural Bodhi self when you ask questions and when you hear the answers. I want to make sure that you challenge every word they say. You know what I mean?
Actually, I was thinking of going to
that'd be amazing.
A protest. If I hear of a march or a protest, to go like really early and then just start recording from the very beginning and be away from any group and just start recording just to get everything about what's going on or get as much as I can. Because the way the news presents it and stuff, and mainstream media is a little off all the time.
Well, again, it depends on who they're hawking and what their narrative is. If you go to the right wing papers, the right wing blogs, and everything, it's the horrible Antifa that want to murder your babies in the middle of the night, and for the left, it's the horrible neo-Nazis that want to round up homosexuals and throw them in a blender. That's what we're getting. that's what we're getting. Nobody's really calmly, and it's hard to calmly look, like you said, Ty. Who's there doing what you just said, to coolly be off, not a participant, but off from a distance? And that's another thing. Who's doing the filming? It's for the most part, we're seeing video from the participants. So the participants, their cameras are going to go. They're not even going to think about it. It's not like they're doing propaganda. They're not even thinking about it. They're going to be examples of Antifa initiating violence. You're going to see that from the Trump people. examples of Trump people initiating violence of Antifa. You're going to see that from the Antifa people. But nobody is, like, stepping back. And where's the media? I mean, well, I mean, I'm playing devil's advocate. We all know that it's a stupid question. But just pretending that the media actually is there to serve the purpose of actually sharing as impartially as possible what's going on in the world. Where's the media doing what Ty said? They could do what Ty is doing, or what Ty is talking about.
Oh, right. Yeah, because they could easily march, right?
They could have cameras, they could use drones. They could use all kinds of things to video and document how things unfolded and begin to understand what's going on. But they don't want to understand, or they already know. Most likely, they already know.
Yeah, I think they already know, because this has been going on for a while, and they're not stupid. They script the whole thing when they even present it. But yeah, that's true. Like, they know of the march. They could be there recording everything, but for some reason it's not there. What they're trying to do is trying to make it look like more of a status left-right problem, okay? Yeah. Not like this are the Antifa and the neo-Nazis itself, and the neo-Nazi happened to mix in within the Trump people. They mixed in because I guess of Trump's rhetoric.
And the Marxists are mixing in with the Antifa.
The Marxists are. They're called tankies. They're not. It's kind of like the alt-right infiltrating. The ones that are infiltrating, like Antifa and ANCOPs, they're called tankies, and they're like hardcore fucking communists. And Antifa, they don't promote that kind of communist. That in reality, they're called tankies. If anybody didn't know. Even the ANCOMs or the Antifas, they call them tankies. They call them out as nasty statist communists. I mean, they do it too. It's happening in both sides in a way. So they're both infiltrated too. But the news really need to present saying these are two factions that have been fighting for so many fucking years, like over 30 years. They're gangs. They're practically kind of like gangs, you know. Antifa, it is kind of like an extreme left, but in the reality, they're not really extreme with anybody, only neo-Nazis. Well, neo-Nazi can be extreme to, if they're a hardcore nationalist, they can be extreme to anybody that's against their idea.
Right.
That's the difference. That's a big difference between the two.
The other thing, the other element that's going on here is, like with the state, and we all understand the state is a myth.
The enemy of my enemy is my friend.
No,
the enemy of my enemy is my friend.
I wasn't going to say that. Not even.
That's what happens too.
That's right. You're right.
That's a better point.
Would you like to make that point, and then I can make mine? Go ahead.
I just made that point.
That's it. You don't want to. You don't have.
It's better than yours.
It is okay. I don't mind.
Fisticuffs.
Okay, let's do this.
Yeah.
So, the state creates this model for rising to the top. What do you get when you rise to the top? What do you have to do to rise to the top? Who is naturally going to be drawn to that? It's, I would say, pretty ruthless, pretty unscrupulous people that are driven to that for the most part, 99% of them. At some level, they have to have some deep psychoses, in my humble opinion. Well, what's happening here is you got They're getting their shields and their helmets and all that stuff. And who's going to be, like, drawn to that? Violent people.
People who are already prone to violence.
People who want to crack skulls. They're not trying to understand. They're not trying. They just want to go out there and bash stuff in.
Right.
So you're going to attract more and more of them to this.
And guess what side they're going to jump in on? The side that's winning.
Yes, exactly. The winning side, yes.
And we see this happens. It's a very human response. They want to be the winners. They want to smash skulls because that makes them feel good, because it's not their skull. Anybody who's benefiting from this violence is going to be supporting it. They're going to be advocating it. They're going to be propagandizing it. They're going to be marketing it.
Right.
And the media has a huge interest. They're using it against us. And we play into it.
Yeah, they're making it a total left-right thing, making it bigger than what it's supposed to be.
Yep.
It's a small pocket of a situation. And they're making it look like the liberals and the Republicans. And then you break out all this war instead of understanding it is Antifa and the fucking white nationalists, okay? It's small it's faction.
It's not a
left-right thing.
Yeah, bring along really. Everybody else, right.
Yes. And it's yes, they're hurting them, basically, into it, into their fight.
It's also creating another narrative that it's in the interest of the state to advance right now, and that is we live in dangerous and violent times, bruh. You know, very dangerous, very violent times. We need to take special actions to ensure the safety of others. My daughter's school leaves messages on our answering machine every Sunday. My daughter goes to a public school. I'm doing peaceful parenting, so my daughter had a choice, homeschool or to stay in the public school, and she's chosen to stay in this public school against what I really want her to do. So she's in this public school, and the school sends this message a few months ago, and I should have recorded it. I missed it. And it was talking about, it was a racism awareness week or something like that at school. And they leave this message. And on this message, they're talking about in these violent times where, you know, it may not seem like peace is possible, but, you know, peace is still possible. It's just, you know, the world is a very ugly and dark place. And, you know, we just have to do our best in a very bad world. That's
if you say so.
That's the message that they're sending our kids. And the reason is because they want to paralyze them with fear. So when the state says, yo, brah, you know, these people, they got too much of these, you know, they have too much power.
Hey, kids, you want some safety?
Yes. Oh, yes, exactly.
Kids, hey, come have some safety. Tell us, we'll keep you safe.
Do your parents have guns?
Don't fret, precious. I'm here. Step away from the window.
Let us know if your parents have guns. Yes, exactly.
Go back to sleep.
Oh, yeah.
So the folks that are gearing up, they're going out to these rallies, and they're putting on their helmets and their sticks and their shields. And, you know, it's ironic to see these the stick man group. I'm going to call them the stick man group. They're going out with their big old B.
Yep.
The stick man group. What's that? That's a... I've been hearing that. Seeing people write it.
They call him Bass Stick Man, so I'm calling it the Stick Man Group. And they have these big shields with the V's on them, and the V is for voluntarism. So that's okay. Whatever. So
voluntary violence.
Color, it could mean violence, but what color V was it actually?
Yeah,
I guess you have a V on.
A gray V, I think. An ANCAP V. I've seen different V's. But, okay, Walt Bedford, this is why it's so important that we fight for peace. Anger on both sides, but we don't have to take sides aside. And see, that's where I'm like, this is not a fight that I want to be involved in. I am not going to show up with my base stick man gear and help to perpetuate. And it is a myth. It's a myth that we live in violent times. We live in the safest times in human history, you freaking morons. And it's not because of the government. Yeah. It's in spite of the government. So
basically.
So I'm not going to be a part of that. My strategy is as things tick off, I'm going to be very prudent. So if I'm surrounded by a bunch of Antifa or if I'm surrounded by a bunch of... Wait, no, I better not say that. Somebody will see this and... use it against me, I'm sure, but basically, pragmatically, oh man, I love you guys. You guys are totally right. Okay, how do I get out of here? And my goal is to get out, to get away from these people and let them do what they do and come back when the dust settles.
If they want to fight, if they want to beat each other up, you know what? Fine, go do it over there.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Just leave me fuck a lot. Leave me out of it.
That's true, actually.
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, no. I even think, you know, how things are being done even on the Antifa side. You know, they're going to Trump rallies where it's mixed in with a lot of innocent people. You know?
Right.
And I guess they're going there because they can find, you know, these neo-Nazis or whatever. But I don't think it's really...
The neo-Nazis were there at Occupy. The neo-Nazis were at Occupy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they were thinking about being part of that, right?
Right, because they were like, oh, yeah, fuck these bankers, yay. It's like, yeah, that's actually what Hitler said, too. Fuck these bankers.
Yes.
Yeah.
It worked.
Yeah, I can't see your face.
Well, he was usually saying, fuck these Jew bankers, so let's...
Right.
But anyway, I'm...
He was a little more specific.
Of course, that's what the neo-Nazis would probably be doing, too. Yeah.
Yeah. If it's a great narrative. A lot of people buy into it because a lot of people see it because it's that common image.
Why are you yo-yoing in the middle of a show? That's inappropriate. You're nervous. You're afraid.
I'm a little nervous.
Why are you?
I'm afraid people are going to come and punch me because of my views of peace.
Yeah, I know because
punch the screen.
Well, you think about it, Bodhi. You think about what it is that you're advocating. You're advocating for not participating, not being a deterrent against people who have bad ideas. So therefore, even if you don't have that bad idea, you're still enabling those bad actors because you're not stopping them. And those bad actors, they are going to trigger off action by the state that is going to perform violence. So therefore, I can punch you in the face.
This sounds really familiar. I remember George Bush saying something along the lines of, if you're not with us,
you're against us. Pretty much.
Oh. You're against us.
Oh.
It's an overall philosophy. The punching philosophy, the helicopter philosophy, will eventually lead to a justification to put everyone in the freaking helicopter. That's where it ends.
Right.
We're going to need a Chinook after all this.
Right. It ends with the last guy who was able to... those last two guys will be struggling to get one of them into the helicopter to push them out. The helicopter will be flying on autopilot. The two dudes will be struggling in the back to push each other out. And then the one dude will finally push the other guy out and it'll be victory. And then I realize, holy crap, we're not going to fly this thing. And then it'll crash. And then that's it. The end of humanity. And you know what? The trees will applaud. Yes, that's right. Trees will be like, yes! Yes, I knew this was going to be the year. I knew. Yeah. You know what, Frank? When you planted the seeds of that whole punching and helicoptering thing, and they actually bought it, dude, that was brilliant, man. That was brilliant. Yo, man, I may be a cedar, but I'm a smart cedar. Yeah.
Hey, the oaks and the maples, man.
Well, yeah. So
yeah, that's a great Rush song, The Trees.
Yeah. Have
you ever heard that?
I haven't.
Oh, you should. It's basically what we're talking about.
So the trees plant the subliminal thoughts to have humanity destroy itself?
So yes.
They can live?
That's
wow. So I did that. I just lived a Rush song in my head and never even heard the Rush song.
Wow. It's a great song, though. The Trees. It's really good.
But anyway, so the punching, helicoptering philosophy leads to death and ruination. And I'm not buying it, and I'm not participating in it. I'm not going to participate in it from the left. This just does not mean that I endorse the stuff
violence
that Trump does. This does not mean that I endorse a lot of the stuff that actual communists, Marxists endorse. I don't. And when I say communists, I mean state communists, Ty. I don't want to trigger you. I'm not advocating for any of that, and I'm going to do my best to try to make it more difficult for them to have their dream come true. I just don't believe going around punching people is going to do it. I think punching people gives them more legitimacy. It gives them it creates more fear among the populace. And fear is the mother's milk of tyranny. And I don't want to be a part of that.
No. So there's no sense. So there's no sense.
If you're advocating for punching, you're advocating for helping to spread fear, which is the mother milk of tyranny. Therefore, you're advocating tyranny. Therefore, I can punch you. Not that right. I will. I'm just using your logic. I could theoretically punch you if I so chose.
Basically, when I see these people running their mouths about punching people, all I see is this giant, like, fisting machine. And every time they spin it, it's fisting themselves and it's fisting their enemy. And it's just this giant circle jerk fist fest. And it's just disgusting. absolutely disgusting. I'm pretty sure there's a Pornhub video.
I think that at this point it would be well. Yeah, but go ahead, Ty.
I think all jokes or any philosophies should be bad, both helicopters and punches. We're just so focused on the punches because the right are so loud and they're repeated in our minds so much, but we have to remember it's both helicopters and punches. And it's going on. If we only acknowledge one side more than the other, it might be hard to fix this situation.
I think that's key. And I think that even for me, I tend to notice what the left does more than the right. And I think
that's just your natural that's your natural bias.
That's my natural bias. Yeah, because I came from the right. So it's kind of
like
it's like that's your team, even though you're not really for your team, that's still your team. So it's like hard to let go your team. And so
I see what you're saying, yeah.
Yeah, it's
because you can relate.
I'm getting better, but
Walt makes a really good point here. This is actually interesting.
Yeah. I want to take this, yes.
On the other side, if I somehow ended up at one of these riots, BS gigs, bullshit gigs, I'll say it. There's no censoring here in the Agora. And I saw someone like you guys getting your ass kicked by anti-fucks, so the neo-fucks.
Can't imagine that happening, Walt. Have you met me? I'm hardcore, man.
He's hardcore.
I'm kidding. I'm not a ninja.
I jump in and light the fucks up. I don't mind them fighting each other, but when they fuck with the common man, I'll participate, but only in defense. Hope that makes sense.
Absolutely.
And I think that's how a lot of people feel.
But
I think that's how a lot of people feel.
I actually step in the middle even.
But you won't find me at those places. Right. Other than to do maybe what Ty is talking about doing, if I could keep a distance and to document it for history or to study it and understand it, then you might find me. But you're not going to find me as a participant on either side. I'm not interested.
And that's kind of like what I did with Occupy. I kind of sat on the outside. I kept an eye out and I watched and I tried to just observe and didn't quite participate, but was there.
There was a girl involved. There had to be a girl involved.
Yeah, I'm not talking about that.
Oh, Daddy was right. I'm smart. But we won't.
She was very crowd stupid, but she wanted to check it out. So I basically had her by the arm and I was like, no, we're not going that way. But everybody's going that way. I'm like, no, you want to get arrested? That's how you get fucking arrested. No.
Do you want to get arrested? Because that's how you get arrested. Right. Right.
It's like, wait, that's not right.
I joined the Navy Sea Cadets, which was a high school thing. I joined the Sea Cadets because of a girl. So I understand.
You went full commie for a girl once.
I went full commie for about a month, and then it did not produce the results that I was hoping that it would produce, so
she
left my commie ways. Who knows what I would have become? She did not. That was the problem. I wanted her to seize the means of my production, and she said no. So I was like, you know what? Communism is it's inefficient. It doesn't work. It was like it doesn't work. She didn't seize the means of my production, so it doesn't work. And that was the end. That was the end of my communist days. So for 1 month of my life, I was a commie. And when I was a little kid, this had nothing to do with a girl. I was just stupid. When I was a little kid, my brother and I, we used to have wars. And he had his country and I had my country. And his country was the United People's Democratic Republic. Okay, we were in sixth grade. But we had the whole school involved in this. Like,
oh my God.
During recess, we had these wars. I mean, we were.
Oh, we have soccer wars.
Well, we had wars.
We had
bows and arrows, and I mean, they didn't hurt you, but you know, out of just twigs and stuff, you know, bows and arrows. We fought wars, and tag wars, all kinds of versions, capture the flag wars, and I was the United Nations National Republic. That was my group.
No, Paul, you were confused.
I wanted a one-world government because I thought a one-world government was the only way that we could protect people from each other to assure that we all had individual liberty. But my goal was always, that it has always been individual liberty. But
yeah.
I thought that was the path. I kept changing because I kept discovering, no, that's not the path. But what I wanted never changed. How mm-hmm. I thought you could get it has been changing through the years until I've ended up here, and I'm in a rather pragmatic place, which is I'm just not sure that individual liberty is what people really want.
No, it's really not.
I don't believe it is.
Because if they wanted it, they could have it.
They could. Tomorrow, if everybody all of a sudden was like individual liberty, all of a sudden the government go ahead, Tony. Yeah,
I think I think they do want it, but I think they're confused on how to do it. Everybody has a different idea of what they want to do with their own self and what they want to work with. That's like the ultimate form of wanting individual liberty. But I think so many people are confused, thinking you need to choose one, because we got so conditioned into voting into things instead of producing things.
Right.
With like-minded people or with on your own. So we got conditioned into voting and somebody doing it for us instead of us making the act or the direct action of what we want.
Yeah, but what I'm
we haven't lived in that society yet.
What I'm saying is that, go ahead, Bodhi. You look like you want to say something. Go ahead.
Nope, I'm still thinking. Go.
Okay, so what I'm saying is that people maybe naturally, if you could remove all the generation upon generation of conditioning that has gone on through coercive enterprises, people might naturally want liberty and the responsibility that comes from that. But the people around us today, at their core, I don't believe that they want the responsibility. They have been so right. strongly conditioned. I don't think you're going to uncondition them. Our best hope seems to always lie in the people to follow, in trying to create spaces where we can provide more and more venues for people as they're growing up to learn self-responsibility, self-ownership. I think the biggest thing is self-responsibility, self-sustainability. If you allow for those conditions to happen, then you'll start to see people that emerge that, I mean, I believe, and I'm not 100% sure, I believe that that is the natural condition for humanity. I'm not 100% sure, but that's what I strongly believe, and that's what I'm working for. But I don't think 90%+ of the people around me are in for following that path.
No, and that's where people are kind of their worst enemy. They don't want to see it. Yeah. They don't want to believe it. They don't want to take responsibility. They don't see how they're responsible for the world that they're living in. And if they can vote and then they can blame the state, or they can blame this other group, or they can blame other people, it alleviates their guilt. And I'm not saying collective guilt, but I'm saying each individual is responsible in some regard. And no one's going to hold you to that but yourself. And if you don't hold yourself to it, well, you're going to start projecting that on others.
I think to a certain degree, liberty requires leadership, self-leadership.
Yes.
And I believe that the people around us, not just in the – I'm not just talking about the United States of America. I'm talking about almost all of the lands of the earth with coercive enterprises, that they have been conditioned – The natural self-leadership has been conditioned out of them. And it's almost like, almost right from birth, the training begins. You have to change the very institutions around you to allow individuals, the babies, the children of today, the space to discover what the power that they already have, the power of self-leadership, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to take some doing, man.
it takes a lot of doing. It's absolutely absurd.
Ty, do you believe that we can see liberty rise in the land by somehow convincing people that Liberty's good, okay?
Well,
I think how I think it is, I think it's just education, you know. I think I'm a little bit used to dealing with people in a certain way. My anarchism started with train hoppers, you know, like 18 years ago. And I learned how to deal with talking with people and educating people. And over time, I learned that it takes time. But the recent situations, it's just been frustrating because I think lately people are like, have so much anger. And I really believe that's from the mainstream media. And people have to really separate.
They're pointing them in that direction, yeah.
Yeah, that's all there is out there to consume. Yeah,
the language that the media...
And people need to really...
The language...
And I think people need to really try to separate the fights between the Antifas and the white nationalist groups, separate from the two-party thing that people are assuming it is. And I think to Antifas, to any of my Antifa friends, like, dude, why go to a Trump rally, you know, talk to people, spread leaflets to other people. I think it's just a waste of time. You go to these Trump rallies where these guys are mixed into the group. Yeah, they're there, but
they're already convinced.
There's a lot of people involved.
Like, why not try to appeal to the moderates? Why not try to appeal to the people that already aren't convinced, the people that aren't yet prone to violence, the people that aren't yet totally in fear, and give them basically create the place for them to exist peacefully, like create that context where you're not exacerbating it. Because if you're going down to these rallies where people are ready for frickin' battle, you're not going to convince them. They've already made their decision. That's why they brought weapons.
Right. Yeah, that's why they got weapons. They got shields. Well, the mace and the tear gas that they're all bringing. It's like you're seeing this. Go ahead.
The whole mace thing kind of is a new thing in a way.
It's going to keep escalating.
That kind of started. Yeah, it's going to keep escalating, but it all started from somebody getting shot, getting sent to the hospital. And that person that went to the hospital was close to a lot of people. He was literally shot in the belly with a gun by an alt-right. And the guy was an alt-right. He turned himself in and admitted alt-right, straight up, like, shot a wobbly out of nowhere. There was no violence, no nothing. He just was so angry. I think he had helicopter memes in his mind, decided to pull out his gun and shoot him in the belly. And then that's where the Antifa started thinking, oh, shit, they might have knives and guns. You might even see it in their conversations. Oh, fucking bring mace, bring this. Because of the actual shooting that happened by the alt-right.
Yep, violence begetting violence.
I mean, Antifa haven't shot a gun yet, but they do shoot. I mean, they do it in Europe. Sometimes they'll shoot.
That's coming.
That's coming.
The gun to
a theater near you.
Yeah,
the gunfights are coming. But here, if I could just, if there's anybody that either they're listening now or if they may be listening, catch this later. It's kind of like the myth of terrorism. I'm not denying that terrorism happens, but if you look at the percentages as far as how many people are actually affected directly by terrorism, it's a really, really small number. And the same is true of these of these rallies and the people that are getting violence performed on them. In percentage of this vast population, it's a very, very small number. But the way that it's being trumped up, you would think that there's violence on the streets everywhere you go, and that's not the case. People are not fundamentally wanting to go attack each other. It's just not. It's not the case.
It's not practical either.
It's not practical. People want to make a living. People are still, at this point, people are still interested in, well, they're watching the Final Four right now. And I can tell you, if this country was full of the overblown violence and turmoil that the media wants you to believe it is, There would be nobody showing up for those Final Four games. You wouldn't see the Final Four dominating your Facebook page right now. So I would say don't believe the hype when you see these, what you're going to read in media newspapers or sites on their shows. They use stuff like extremists, far right, far left, hate groups, mm-hmm. Whatever they use incendiary language, and the media, there's a little thing called AP styling, and AP styling is what the news uses to get in some ways. AP styling is very practical, like it does things like there's a conventional way for you to write time down. So all the newspapers, all the news media, they follow AP styling. So there's this shared format. But they go beyond that. They go beyond that to how you describe certain groups. And the language is changed from a small group of people, change that language for all the newspapers, all the news media, and it's updated all the time. So that a lot of that language that you hear, folks, that's like
copy-paste.
That's copy-paste. That's very intentional. It's the news media knows when you're talking about this group, you use this word. When you're talking about this type of action, you use this type of word. And the words they pick are designed to elicit a response from you. It's not designed to give you...
very clever marketing.
Yeah, it's very clever marketing. It's not designed to give you a space to discern what's true, what's not true. It's designed to get you to say what they want you to say is true.
It's designed to sell you a product. All you see and hear and read on TV is basically begging for your dollar.
Yeah, and the product is state security. The product is state security. That's what I'm going to say.
Yep. I'd buy that for a dollar.
I would not.
Yeah.
I meant your theory.
If I could, because if I could buy state security for a dollar, I would, and then I'd trash it. So, please, sell it. Sell me the whole of state security, and I will dismantle it immediately. Yeah. So the thing is that we have technology that's advancing that is allowing people to be so much more individualistic, so much more expressive. Okay, Ty, where are you calling us from? If you want to divulge your location or not, you don't have to.
Oh, I'm from I'll say Georgetown, California.
So he's California, Bodie. You're in.
I'm in New Hampshire,
and I'm in Pennsylvania. We all met each other online. If I didn't have the interwebs and all the connections that we all know within our local areas that. By and large, there aren't a lot of people that think like us. If we didn't have all this type of interconnectivity that we have for the media, we might think that we're some sort of alien orphan weirdos. And we'd probably we wouldn't have people to bounce our ideas off. We got a thought idea. We have this discourse and our ideas are more rapidly progressing because we have more people that we could share our ideas with. We got 3D technology, which is developing, which is going to create local manufacturing, home manufacturing. There's all kinds of things arising right now. This is the best time to be alive right now in all of human history. This is the best time. We have every reason to be optimistic and hopeful, but all you see is rallies. All you see is bloody Trump supporters and Antifa being driven into the ground. All you see is racist. All you see is communist. Meanwhile, while you guys are screaming and hollering at each other, the rest of us are on the business of actually seeing liberty emerge despite what the state is doing. It can't stop. Well, I won't say it can't. I won't use an absolute. Yeah. But it would be very difficult for the state to stop the advance of technology that is tilting, it's making it increasingly difficult for the state to justify its existence, its product. Its product is becoming obsolete before its very eyes, and it knows it.
It knows it, and it's going down screaming.
Yeah. Yeah, and we got the technology at the right timing, too. Like, I also think all this chaos is happening because of the technology, and I think from all this chaos, a lot more things will come out more for more people. That way, more people can understand what's going on or what is really happening behind the scenes. Who are these people? And we're all connecting and talking and then getting even a better picture. So I think the chaos, in a way, is produced by these technologies, but I think it happened because we're all connecting. And then, yeah, I'm very optimistic of the water settling in many areas. So it's like very optimistic. So yeah, I see it in that way also, but especially with technology.
You know, the interesting thing, though, about what I believe that the people who advocate for coercive enterprises, whether they're left, right, or whatever other gradation, that are, and I'm talking about the people, the architects, the planners and designers at the top. I'm not talking about the rank and file folks. I'm talking about the real planners and designers. These folks are playing a dangerous game because on one hand, they're trying to use violence, uncertainty, insecurity to through fear to get people to turn to the state and say, well, no, the state still provides a product. See, it's keeping us safe. But at the same hand, while they're doing that, more people, well, I won't say more people, well, more people than us, they're creating people like us too. Because there are many people who are looking at that and like, you know, my answer is not when I see this insecurity and all this stuff. My answer is not, oh, I got to turn to the state. My answer is, oh, the state can't even protect us. What the heck? What good is it? What usefulness is it? And I think they, I would assume that they know that. I would assume that in their mind they're thinking, you know, we're gonna create a lot less ties than we will Trump supporters, than we will Clinton supporters. So it's worth it. It's a, you know, we get more out of it than we lose. But you know, when we go back to the arrows, and this is why I think it's sad that amongst a community of people that we do reject the state, we fundamentally reject the state coercive model, but among us, we're fighting over whether the NAP will allow your kid to be sold, you know, into slavery or not, or whatever ridiculous,
just absolutely useless arguments.
So we have this core, clear to understand vision, which is there's a better way. There is a free association way that we can govern ourselves, and it will have all kinds of incredible variations within it. I don't care about the freaking variations, but there is a better free association way. We, a small number, a tiny number, we could get all of our arrows pointed in the right direction, and we could be like Antifa. We could be like, in terms of a small group of people affecting a whole bunch of other people around us, because the other people around us, their arrows are pointed all kinds of different ways.
Yep.
If our arrows were all pointed in the same direction, we had a simple unifying, and I, you know, I'm not calling, this is not a call to unity. I don't believe, I think unity is creepy.
No.
I know that sounds weird, but
a lateral alignment. Let's all move in the right direction. Let's all reject violence.
Senseless
violence. Let us defend what needs to be defended, but there is no need for aggression.
Right. I like to call it opportunities for cooperation. Yeah. If we created a wider space for opportunities for cooperation among people who, one thing we all have in common, we reject the coercive enterprise model. We embrace a free enterprise model. I mean, free association model. We embrace free associations. I mean, that's more basic even than, well, is it a communist market? Is it a mutualist market? Is it a primitivist or whatever? You know what? Free association, let's free them all, let liberty sort them out, and we'll find out what works. I don't think it's going to be one thing that works. I think that different regions, different cultures will have different systems that work best for them. And I mean, there's not going to be one way. So if we ever get that to that point, to that basic elemental opportunity for cooperation, then I think that their gamble will be lost. That even though they're creating way more Hillary and Trump supporters than they're creating ties and Bodies, the Ties and the Bodies are going to be much more of an influencer on the culture around them than the Hillary's Clinton supporters and the Trump supporters.
Right. I mean, we're an easy pill to swallow. It's not, you know, we're not very, we're not exactly jamming things down people's throats.
Right.
You know, even though people would tell you otherwise. Oh, you just want to blah, 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 blah. You're a commie. Block.
Well, yeah.
You're lying.
In a way, if you think about it, like, say, with this future technology, there will be different communities, different societies, right? Just like whether ANCOM or mutualist or whatever.
Primitivist, will still be whatever.
On the internet. Yeah, right, we'll still be community in the internet. And we'll probably all be getting along because everybody figured it out. Like, oh, yes, I live in this ANCOM community. Oh, nice, I'm a mutualist or whatever it is, or ANCOM. Oh, and everybody settled
it. They'll still be bickering. It's not going to be utopia, but... I mean, there's still going to be meme wars.
Yeah.
There's still going to be meme wars, yeah. Dude.
Yeah, there'll be. That's true. There'll be meme wars. There'll be people talking shit. People talking shit about each other's bands. People talk shit about people's ideas still, even to this day. But it'll be like a more of a simplified, I think, how I look at it, more simplified of a talking shit, more jokey, too, in a way.
Right.
But not very utopic. And there might be very, there's still going to be very aggro individuals being like so hardcore something. And say, but, I never leave this little city or something, you know. There's right. also that.
But that I think, is, and I think we don't have to do as much as many would think. I think it's essentially a self-correcting problem. As long as you distance yourself from these people that want to aggress, these people that want to advocate for violence to solve these problems, if you just let them go do their thing, they're going to sort themselves out.
That's true, huh?
Well, yeah, that's right. That's what I'm saying. Freedom like what all, I was let saying. Liberty sort it out. Exactly.
If you want to go sit there and fucking shoot each other,
okay.
Just don't shoot me, and we're good.
You'll implode. You know, that's your business.
Exactly. That's kind of like what I was saying earlier. Like, if people can understand and really decipher what's happening with the fight between Antifa and neo-Nazis, they'll just leave it all behind and fuck all the memes. They wouldn't think it's a total left or right dilemma or a left anarchist or a right anarchist dilemma, because it's not. It has nothing to do with none of them. This is an Antifa white nationalist issue. These are extreme left and extreme right. I don't really think Antifa is extreme left, but they're extreme and like where they'll take care of shit or whatever, you know.
I think that's the beauty of. I think that's the beauty of He Will Not Divide Us. I really do. I
love this whole. I think
love it.
I don't think Shia LaBeouf is a fool. I think that he is a master troll, is what I think. I love it.
Yeah, I saw some of the memes today. Someone was posting them.
Go ahead, Ty. I'm sorry.
Yeah, go, Ty. Go. That's fine.
Oh, I looked into it more when you mentioned it. When I seen it, and I go, wait. I think he really fucked with them. How did he easily cross all that shit with the flag and everything?
It's ridiculous.
Exactly. It was like, wow.
No, I think that he does put the flags up, and I don't think that he sets it up so that they're found, but I think he knows they're going to be. And it's brilliant. I mean, it's just, I mean, I love 4chan. In this aspect, I love what they're doing. They're master trolls too, and I just think that they're the ones being trolled. And you know what? It's a beautiful thing. If I had the time to waste participating, I don't. But if I did, I would be totally fun. Even if I knew I was being trolled, I would still try to find that freaking flag because it's fun. It's hilarious.
It's fun. It's peaceful. It's nice.
It's still fun.
Yeah, it's great. I love it. He will not divide us. It's so beautiful. He will not divide us. Yeah, he will. It's kind of what's going on, right? It's like the very creation of the statement, he will not divide us, is creating division. Right. And I think it's... I don't think
the irony escapes him. I really don't.
I don't think it does. I mean, I could be totally wrong. He would be just totally a dunderhead who, you know... I mean,
he could just be a really successful actor and media marketer
Or he could have like a genius marketer behind him, maybe. Who knows?
Maybe.
He's got like some secret friend that's like, yo, man, you want to do this next? Really? Nothing stupid. Yeah, you want to do this next? And it would be perfect if you find out it's a guy behind him. Because then when he goes out and he's outraged, it would be totally authentic. Or he could just be great. Well, he's a fine actor. I mean, so.
He's a great actor.
Yeah, he is. So there's no reason to believe that he can't be out there and like convincingly say, I can't believe they're doing this to me. And he's like, dude, have you seen him rap?
No.
Didn't you see that video where he's on, I forget what it's called, what, freestyle, whatever, where you just rap off the top of your head? You know, I'm not down with my raps. But he was on some sort of legendary radio station, legendary rap radio station with the raps. And apparently it's this big thing where they have you rap. And they change beats, and there's like this thing they take you through. They use it for rappers, and most of the good rappers, like well known rappers, they don't make it through, and
wow.
And they tease out. Well, he freestyling, he totally. I mean, it's incredible. He totally nailed it, and he got all the way through. He totally bossed it. I mean. Yeah, I respect rappers, by the way. You have to have a really quick mind to be an effective rapper.
You really totally. Do.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't particularly like rap.
Especially freestyler.
But I do respect rappers. The good ones. Not the ones that are just going, I'm lazy, you're my fleet, and then I'm gone. I'm going to shoot you in the head, and then I'm low. I don't mean those rappers. I mean like the ones that are really spinning, you know.
They're spitting their wares, bro.
Spitting their wares, yeah. Those dudes, the dudes and dudettes. Those.
But Paul, we're really white. We really can't talk about this.
I'm not white.
Funny.
Wait, why are you laughing at me,
Ty? Well, at least if you've been in a certain neighborhood, at least if you've been in the certain neighborhoods or certain situations, you probably has heard a certain way or different.
Yeah. No, I'm not white. I am
but
offended.
A lot of that stuff can be really crazy, too.
I am offended at that, Bodhi.
That's fine. You can be offended.
I am offended.
You can be a little snowflake.
You are saying that I belong to
Paul's a little snowflake, white and stout.
I'll wait.
He blows the steam when everyone runs out.
I'll wait.
I got the rhymes that can go for days. No,
not a freestyler. I'm not either, so I won't say anything.
Sorry.
No, I take offense at that because the white is the white race, which belongs to the species of Homo sapiens sapien. That is the species that you dogs belong to. Whether
that's
you're
right.
White,
you're the Neanderthal.
Whether you're black, whether you're whatever other.
Can you tell by his forehead that he's Neanderthal? He had me fooled.
I am, and even calling me a Neanderthal, because that is my slave name. I am not a Neanderthal. I am an OP. I am an original person. I was here. But don't give me that smirk. I don't want to hear
it. Frozen.
Oh, good. You know what? What a place for Ty to be frozen, right there. That is perfect. She looks totally stunned, amazed, and
you're just like
so
why
many
did I,
things. Oh,
why did
oh,
I
well,
do this show?
Why am I on with these people? But I am 4% OP, which is higher than 99%. And really, the 4%, I can feel it. I can actualize it because I have that level of wokeness that I am aware. That,
ooh, now you're big. You're bigly on the screen.
I'm bigly. Yo, get them biglies. I get the biglies. So that 4%, I can feel it. I've actualized it. And I am OP. That is the dominant, really, the Homo sapiens sapien part. The OP is already taking that stuff out, man. More and more. And I think maybe within a year or two, I will have no more of the Homo sapiens sapien in me, and I'll be hardcore OP.
There you go. Ties back.
And as Hello? An as okay, Ty, and you get to hear this last part here. as an OP'er, I have lands that belong to me that you Homo sapiens took from me. I'm talking about Europe. Okay? You guys have European descendants, both of you. When I look at you, actually, I think oppression. I think
Ty, we don't have Ty's video though. He's gonna have to clicky clicky.
Ty, activate your video, or I probably view that as an act of aggression if you don't. And then you could probably be punched.
And my video's not on?
Now it is.
I think it's coming on now. It's coming on now. So I'm thinking you guys have reparations. You guys have reparations to pay me?
Ty? You guys?
Yeah, you guys. It's your ancestors that tried to wipe out the OP, the original people, me. Now I want my land and I want my money. And I also want you to have Homo sapiens sapien guilt for the rest of your lives. And acknowledge your Homo sapiens sapien privilege. That'd be great. So don't call me white. Now you know. Don't do that.
Call you white again. I'm sorry.
Don't call me by my oppressor's name.
You're all white to me. It's fine.
That's inappropriate. You Homo sapiens sapiens are all alike. You know, just because you showed up and you have more tools than us, you thought, well, we have more tools than them. Let's just try and kill them. So that's what you did.
You know, that's kind of where it all started. The first base stick man.
Dude, that explains a lot.
Holy shit.
Wow. That is your ancestors, Ty, not mine. My ancestors, no base stick man. No base stick man in our ancestry. We were peaceful. We were anarchists. We were the first. We were the original anarchist, the OP.
Oh, we were panarchists before there was.
You were statists.
Do you like panarchy?
Yeah, exactly.
You're a little muffled, Ty.
Yeah, you are a little muffled.
Something's happening to my computer.
There you go. You're good now. I think you're covering the microphone.
You're good now. So panarchy. Describe what is panarchy.
Oh, what is panarchy?
Yeah,
panarchy is a system that calls for total decentralization, right? Like, it's an anarchist system, and it's total decentralization. But the also it's weird with panarchy is like people can also overlap areas too, and I guess with panarchy is like you're working with. Certain systems that kind of like or communities. So you go move to a community, it's an ANCAP community or an ANCOM community. ANCOM community or any type community, and basically you have a what you call a contract with that community, and that contract is what insures, what gives you insurance for like health or the just like basic name. So panarchy is basically you're getting into. It's the same thing. It's just decentralization. You know.
It's basically a social contract that you're actually allowed to sign.
Yes, and you can unsign. Yeah. An actual social contract, not a mythological. You're born into it and you can't escape it. Well, you could technically escape.
Yeah.
It,
not
free association.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so what you're talking about, I call them there are distributed communities and then there's contiguous communities, and what seems like you're talking about is that in panarchy, you'd have both, and you could belong to more than one community because you could be along to this community for this type of service, and yeah, that's kind of what I see is all things it's being equal.
It's basically an actual open market. You can.
Yeah.
You go to the Agora and you get what you need.
There you go.
Right.
Yes. It's an actual open market.
Hey, Bodhi.
Hey.
It's the unsegregated container.
It really is. And what's funny is like when I first came up with my name for the page and stuff, I didn't even completely understand agorism or anything. I just liked the word Agora.
Remember when you were doing a live stream game show, okay, a live stream video game, yep. And you were talking about the name Agora, and you're like, oh yeah, it's like that video game Agora, and you're like, no, Agora is the ancient Greek. It's a marketplace. Nah, no, it's not.
No, it's that video game.
No, it's like, that video game. No, it's.
Actually, I'm like, no, I had no idea that even existed. Like,
there's no way.
Right.
It's like, yes way. I'm telling you, please, like, listen.
And that guy will vote. So.
That guy votes. Yeah.
Did you punch him in the face?
No, I didn't punch him in the face.
I don't know why he votes, man.
Well, if I punched him in the face, he would have voted harder.
My wife voted in the last election. I should punch her. I'm going to go. You know what? I'm going upstairs. I got to go punch my wife because she voted. That seems good. Hey, right?
It's really weird how the whole punch in the face got extended to voters instead of just focused on the
I extended it to voters by their logic. They were only talking about the people at these rallies.
What's funny about it is even like especially with anarchists who are they're the ones punch voters, blah 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 blah. But they're the first ones to say your vote doesn't matter.
Right. So your vote doesn't matter. I'm going to punch you in the face because you're going to cause violence. Pick one. I just did a pick one.
Woo! Pick one.
Wow.
I just did a pick one.
Yeah. Next thing you know, I'm going to be selling children into slavery. It's a slippery slope.
Yep. That's what that actually, is. Don made a really good comment earlier. He was like, yeah, all children are born slaves to their parents.
Right.
Boom.
Yeah. Well, that's another Boom. Conversation. That's another conversation. Which
statism starts in the womb.
Boom. No, I don't agree with you.
If you're not careful.
Yeah, I really think these fears can really be minimized once we understand what's really going on. And I even hope that even the Trump supporters, you know, the voter aspects, understand who got mixed in their into their groups. That way they can see what's going on, and if they understand the history of the Antifa and white nationalist groups always having to fight. I mean, they've been doing this every year. Like, it's nothing new. Even before Trump. If they understand this, then they go, oh, this is what's happening. This is what's really going on. They, you know, they probably think those Antifa guys are like Democrats or something, you know, and they're not. It's just a...
Yeah, just
they're extreme left anarchists.
They're liberals.
Well, except that's
or liberals or something.
If they go to Europe and they're like, oh, there's a liberal rally, blah, 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 blah. How do you people stand this? And it's like, wait, no, actually, you'd actually agree with them over here.
That's true. It's just used, the wording is used a little bit different.
Yep. And I only learned that by, get this, by playing video games and playing with people around the world and having these discussions and realizing that, oh, man, these words mean different things to different people.
Well, yeah.
They do.
Shocker.
They literally do.
Shocker. Yeah. Absolutely shocking.
And it's easier when you're gaming, too, because you're having just basic talks. You're not really stuck with caught on understanding what's what. You're just talking to guys somewhere else, and then you're asking how it works that way, you know?
Right. You're just genuinely curious. You're actually probably on the same team, and you're working to a common goal, and then you're a little more friendly. And I think if... If we could actually highlight these common goals
how we can work together. We're not calling out, let's all work together. It's creating opportunities for cooperation wherever they may arise. We don't all always have to work together. Nobody's talking about creating some sort of large hierarchical organization. But it's like, okay, we all understand. We're all on the same page. So when we're working on stuff that deals with this very narrow area, which is like if we're talking about just allowing for the for free associations to flourish versus coercive enterprises, whenever we're talking about something at that basic level, I should be able to work with an ANPRIM, an ANCOM. I should be able to work with anyone who has fundamentally rejected a coercive enterprise. Now, if I'm working on something that is more specific, more granulated, I may not work with an ANCOM on that. But But so he said, yeah, we're just creating these opportunities for us to work together on the areas where we can work together, where we can, for whatever reason. You know, something will arise. We'll work. We'll do this project, and then boop, okay, we're off, and we're doing something else, and we got another group of people that we're working on. So we get these associations. Some of them will last longer than others, but most of them will probably, like, rise and fall as the needs and the functions arise. And so you can have a diverse group of people actually coming together to do effective things. Like, what if, and I mean, I'm just, what if somebody said, hey, man, let's try to, whoever's interested in doing this says, let's try to gather up all our intelligence for how these groups are really forming, how these rallies are really happening. Wherever, you know, people, you know, let's all try to, you know, we have these multiple hubs where we're gathering videos and we're gathering in Google Hangouts or Skype conversations, and we're analyzing and we're taking that analysis. We're all producing this content that anybody can use however they want, you know, BIPCOT the world. You take all this content, and then all these people have all this information to go out and talk to everybody else about, this isn't what you see. And look, I got videos. I got proof. I could show you. This is not, it's not as violent as you think it is, and it's not as widespread, and it's involved in very small groups that are actually fighting each other. I mean, that would be an example where you could see people across the sphere, from ANCOM to IAMPRIM to ANCAP to Agorist, whatever. You could see in that kind of venue, all these people could contribute.
Yeah. As long as you can give basically show them where their effort can be useful and positive and whatever, and it'll be rewarding. That's what I advocate. Right there. Yeah, be productive.
That's what NAPOD TV is supposed to be.
Well, no, NAPOD TV is not anything.
NAPOD TV is a place where we're aggregating artistic expression.
And no, that's the Agora. And NAPOD TV is just
you described that before.
And NAPOD TV is not TV. That's all it is.
You've described it differently before.
I was mistaken.
It was going to be a platform where you're going to have all these artists doing all kinds of
weird NAPA art. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Remember that?
Yeah, but then no artists contributed.
So you're like,
Paul Gordon.
I contribute all kinds of things. I contribute ideas. And I give you meme and shirt ideas all the time, dude.
You gave me Lulzilla.
Dude. Oh, that's hurts. That hurt.
That Lulzilla hurt.
Lulzilla
hurt a lot of people.
It hurts me.
It was a great show. It was a great show, and it just...
I've triggered Bodhi. Actually, Devotee triggered me, and then my trigger triggered Bodhi.
Yeah, we got a trigger thing going.
Yeah. he's not dead. He's in a deep, 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 deep hibernation.
Deep, deep hibernation underneath the polar ice cap.
Yeah, underneath the polar ice cap. Yeah,
oh, my God.
He's the guy!
He's in the South Pole.
Oh, that's why we could never find him. We've been looking for Santa Claus Pole, and he's been in the South Pole the whole time. We got to send out a crew.
We got to send out a crew. We got to get Lulzard out.
We got to get Lulzard out of the South Pole.
Oh, man. We still have to cover Zealandia. I'm sorry, Hong Kong Fui.
Yeah, we got to cover Hong Kong Fui. I don't know if Ty would like to cover Hong Kong Fui.
It's Hong Kong Fui.
Well, Hanna-Barbera is basically the real Illuminati. That's essentially what we discovered.
Because it started with I came across a meme, and it was Scooby-Doo traced over Australia. Yes. And it turns out that Australia is, in fact, Scooby-Doo. And Indonesia is actually known as the Scooby Snacka.
Scooby Snacka, right?
Scooby Snacka, right on the snoot of Scooby Doo.
Right there.
And then I started digging into it, and I found out that Guam is actually Dino the Dinosaur.
Right. We did that show.
Yep. And then I started doing further analysis, and then this whole thing came out about Zealandia being this new continent underneath New Zealand. And I started looking at it, and sure enough, it's Hong Kong Fui.
It's Hong Kong Fui, which is a Hanna-Barbera character.
These are all Hanna-Barbera characters. They're all dogs. And
Coincidence? I think not.
I don't think so. No. I think, you know,
no.
It's the theory flat earthers don't want you to talk right. about because it's a much flatter earth.
The flat earthers are distracting us. They think they're woke, but they're actually distracting us from the we're wokeness. The earth is not flat. It's Hanna-Barbera. That's the thing.
And now we got to look into the claims of that mass underneath the South Pole. I think it might be Lulzard.
We're going to have to look into that. And Lulzard is, by the way, the anti-Hanna-Barbera, so it would be quite interesting if that was true.
Yep. But that's part of creating a more positive avenue and outlet for discourse. Have fun with it.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. In all seriousness, that's what we do. We do these jokey, stupid. Well, it's really amazing. The first one we did with Scooby-Doo, there were people that were on commenting on that video. If you go look for it, where's that on? Is that on the?
It's on Napaw TV.
It's on Napaw. If you go to Napaw TV, you find it. But there are people on there that they're commenting like, "Oh my gosh, I can't believe these idiots really believe this." And we're like,
yeah.
I can't believe that you believe we believe. And if you listen to it, we're so absurd. We're
so out of it.
Way out there on purpose.
I mean, some guy literally commented, I shared it somewhere, and he was like, "Thanks for wasting my time on a 30-minute joke." And I was like,
"You watched the whole
thing. You watched the whole fucking thing.
Dude, you know what? You owe me. You should pay me because I entertained you for 30 minutes, son."
Right.
And you know, like, I did because you kept watching. You were intrigued.
Were you not entertained?
Yes. Yes. Have we not entertained you? And that's what it's about.
Gosh.
And Lulzilla is a show which was about, maybe we'll talk about this off camera, Bodie, but
actually we should probably wrap up the stream. We're kind of drifting. So yeah. sit tight.
I'm gonna close my show up too. I'm doing a show too. At the same time. Well, I'm not live streaming it, but I'm recording it and I will do stuff with it.
I'll tell you something after I cut the stream that you might laugh about that. Okay. I'm glad I didn't do, but I almost did.
Okay. And we're out.